Good day, Cayman football fans, and good day to the broader community. We have lots of football news to talk about, and here joining me, of course, Cayman Compass sports journalist Seaford Russell, is Mr. Alfredo Whittaker, Cayman Islands Football Association president, of course. Mr. Whittaker, first of all, thank you for joining me here. How are you doing?
Everything is great. Thanks for having me, and we're looking forward to great conversation and looking forward to a great weekend of football.
Absolutely. Let's start with the World Cup qualifiers that you guys have just finished wrapping up. I believe you just came out of quarantine as well. If you could just take me back to the trip and the trips that you guys take, in fact, took, and just tell me how all that came together and what was the overall experience of those two first games in the FIFA World Cup qualifiers.
The trip overall was good. A lot of challenge in the road. From our departure from Miami to Suriname was quite challenging. Had to wait at the airport in Curacao for about 3.5 hours before getting our charter flight that would take us to Suriname. We had to wake up at 5 o'clock in the morning to get COVID tests. We didn't get that done until about 9 o'clock.
Yeah.
And then the return from Suriname after the game was the biggest challenge that we had. Initially, our departure was at 9 a.m. and we didn't leave until 1:30 p.m. Upon an arrival in the U.S., the private airport in Sarasota did not, the U.S. Borders control did not allow us to land there. So we was circling for a while. We had to go to Miami. When we was about to land in Miami, they did not allow us to land in Miami because the flight was not a scheduled flight to arrive in Miami. So eventually, after about another 2 hours, after 5 hours flying from Suriname to Florida, we get the okay to land in Tampa.
Yep.
The airport in Tampa was closed, so we had to wait on the tarmac for another 2 hours for the authorities to come and do their setup and clearance. So eventually we didn't get to our hotel until about 12 o'clock at night. This is now Friday morning. So we went to bed like about 1:30, 2 o'clock. The next day, Friday, was our training. And then from there we had some issues with COVID tests that was blow completely out of proportion. It's simple. The labs in Florida, they don't open Saturdays and Sundays.
Right.
They do not provide you with a 5 hours or 6 hours test result like in the Cayman Islands. They provided a 48-hour result. So obviously our result didn't get done until Friday. We wouldn't get it done in time for the match. But anyhow, that was dealt with FIFA initially, and obviously CONCACAF and the Canadian Football Association.
Yep.
There was quite understanding with the situation. We came to agreement that the game would be played on Monday instead of Sunday. So we get our test, the game was played, and that was the end of it. Unfortunately, some people and some entities that like to exaggerate and create all of these animosity for things that happen in sports took the opportunity to try to blow that out of proportion. But at the end was simply nothing. Things happen.
Right.
We managed to play the game, and this story we all know.
And what a game it was. I mean, Canada defeated the home team, of course, 11-0. A score line that was expected by many, and for some, what it came as a shock. But that game against Canada was one that had many different ventures before, during, and after. We got a press release issued to us anonymously, and I just wanted to get your take on this press release that highlighted several issues that you are claimed to be facing with FIFA. What exactly transpired there, and I know that the hearing was I believe on the 15th. What came out of that?
I haven't got a response yet, and I think the reason why is because I highlighted almost two pages of things that was not done right regarding the preparation of a match. Maybe some people before the assumption of wrongdoings from our side, or from my side in this case, should have gone back a little bit and taken consideration or to remember the years of experience that I have in this industry, not only as a football player that we're talking over 16 years, but also as a FIFA referee, that is another 9 years, plus another 3 years as head of refereeing for the CONCACAF from the CFU region. Not to mention the 100 of games as a referee assessor. So the preparation of a match is simple. The match commissioner have the duties and responsibilities. Now, by we being a small country, and by we not having big names in our association or in our delegation, all of the highlights was turned towards the Canadian national team. So I was the first one to make a verbal report regarding the match commissioner not fulfilling her duties and responsibilities in this case. So I think for FIFA disciplinary, when they read what I report, it become a shocker, and they're probably looking into taking some other decisions with this match commissioner. Two things, I'm not going to go in big details because there is still some things that have to be done.
Right.
Our national flag, the Cayman Islands flag, was not displayed, and the reason why is because she claimed that the Canadian flag was too small, and the Cayman flag and the FIFA flag was too big. So our flag was not displayed.
Wow.
Our duties and responsibilities primarily is to visit the team official training. We did not get that visit, but yes, the Canadian did get that visit. So I highlighted those things. And just a third one, in protocols, when your home team, like the Cayman Islands was the home team, the first national anthem to play would be the Canadian, and the Cayman Islands national song would be the second item to play. In this case, it went the opposite. I was the one who provided a Zoom link to have a match coordinating meeting.
Right.
She's supposed to get that done. Right. The Canadian had the passport check in person, like how it's supposed to be. I had to be sending pictures via WhatsApp for her to check. So the check in person of the Cayman Island passport with the player never did get done. And the list go on. So I'm pretty sure FIFA is looking into that. So that is the end. That is a quick highlight of things that was not properly done before and after our match. There is the list continue.
Yeah, and in a nutshell, I mean, again, the hearing was last week. Is everything now resolved?
I would take the adventure and say that yes. Just for your knowledge and your audience, this is absolutely nothing that would jeopardize the Cayman Island Football Association. Is not is a proceeding. I want to hear how you're going to address what was said.
Right.
I want to see what, if any, code of disciplinary was breached or was not followed.
Yep.
We have to be clear. One thing is disciplinary hearing, right? And a complete different thing that would be more alarming or alarming when you have a ethics committee hearing, because now you broke ethics and now you have, you know, that suspension and things could happen. Right. So that is, it's just a disciplinary something, right? The information was provided to the press. I think, I'm not sure how, but we will get to that.
To a more positive light here on a domestic league or tournament, rather, the FA Cup has now kicked off. Eight teams now moving into the quarterfinals this weekend to be played, if I'm not mistaken. I just want to get your initial thoughts on the FA Cup and what this tournament means to Cayman football. I know that it was not a part of the last season, but it's here now. Just walk me through the FA Cup and the teams that are now heading into the quarterfinals after round one.
The FA Cup is always exciting. Is a game that is being played without a margin of error.
Yeah.
There is no mistakes on the field. When you're disputing for the football, there shouldn't be no mistakes off the field. Because you're going into a second round and you want to make sure that you are rested, you're ready to play, yeah. Because you have to do or die.
Yeah.
This weekend we saw some competitive games. We had some really good surprising results, I would say. Past weekend. This weekend now is another big one, right? We had some big games last week. We had the Latinos versus Bordentown. That was very challenging.
Yep, it's always challenging.
Always challenging, yep. and full of emotions. We had Academy, the young Academy team,
yep.
that face off Georgetown. The game start off well. Academy is a very young and talented team, so they came up on top. And then the other big games for this weekend, we could look Academy going against East End. Now we have Scholars that is facing off Elite.
Okay.
Right? We have the clash of the playoff between Cayman Athletic and Sunset.
Okay, nice.
So, and then when you go to the girls also have some big games like Elite playing against Scholars or Scholars Elite, and the Latinas that is there against
Sunset,
right? So the weekend is full of good football.
Yeah.
The weekend is full of nice activity, and we're looking forward to a very enjoyable Sunday of football.
Yeah, to that end, I mean, Cayman in football during this season has really shaped up very nice in comparison to previous seasons. I really enjoyed covering football this season. But one of the things that has always been asked is more teams coming to the league, and if someone wants to enter a team into the league, how do they go about that? Because at the moment, I believe the Premier League has 10 or 11 teams
11.
Within it. Yeah.
The Premier League have 10 teams. The first division have 11 teams. The first division have the possibility of growing, because remember this year we had clubs that are registered clubs,
right,
such as Northside that did not enter competition. Tigers that did not enter competition.
Yeah.
So we're looking forward for those two teams to join in next season, first division. So we could have a total of 13.
That'd be great.
Maybe we have Alliance that recently won the first division. Maybe they enter a first division team also. That would make it 14. Right? We're looking at different ways of making football better, different ways of making the league more competitive,
yep.
different ways that our competition would benefit our national team.
Correct.
We not only go and watch the games. When me and the coaches go and sit down, we take time. So our average playing time, live playing time in a competitive game is 22 minutes.
Yep.
That is way too low. Right? So back to the comments of the Canadian, of Cayman facing off Canadian on that 11-0, right? At some point, is the reality of our football. At some point, somebody made the big mistake, one of your guests and the coach from the Canadian national team made a mistake in their big mouth and said that was a statement that the Canadian made, right? So when you want to make a statement against the Cayman Island national team, and at the same time, 2 days after, you're losing a qualification to Olympic games.
Yeah.
I don't know who really making a statement or what statement you're making. And if at the end of the World Cup qualifiers, you don't qualify to that World Cup, I don't know what statement you really made and what process or how the process really went well or how well organized your process went. Now I could tell you that from our league, the structure of our league and what we are implementing in the league, our national team definitely going feed off that. And our structure would be a structure that in a short and medium term would give us the benefit that all of us are looking for.
Right.
Especially at the youth level. We understand the competition at senior level with the age group that we have is very difficult.
Mm-hmm.
But at our U23, at our U20, our U17, and I could adventure right now, our U15, we have a solid foundation.
Yep.
And the Cayman Islands would compete and compete very well. We have two little 16-year-olds that one of them put in 1 hour and 15 minutes with a senior national team. And another one that put in 63 minutes.
And you're speaking about Jackson Biles.
And Justin Biles.
Right.
And then we have a bunch of little 18-year-olds that put in plenty time.
Right.
And we have a lot of 20, 21-year-olds that put in 180 minutes. Right. So when we look into that, before making some comments, we should say, like, hold on, wait a minute. Something is working here and it will work.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we probably play Canada again next 50 years.
And win.
Right?
Yeah.
You never know. We might play Canada in a U20. The result not going to be the same. I could guarantee you that. Right? So, we are working. And please, we have to be realistic. Don't expect. We recently changed the whole entire format of football in Cayman.
Yeah.
Until now, this is the first year in over 15 or 20 years that the Cayman Islands players are playing a significant amount of football. We normally would play 16 games and we rest, I don't know, 4 months.
Right.
Now we are playing 20, 26 games. The U23 league is about to be announced. I would guarantee 80% of our Premier League players and national team players will continue to play.
Yep.
Right? So all of this is added. You have to give things time to get good results.
Right.
You're not going to plant a mango tree today and collect good mangoes 2 months down the line. You have to give it time.
Gotcha. I mean, switching gears away from the local scene, over the weekend, I'm sure you saw that there's the announcement of the Super League. I just wanted to get your initial thoughts on that and what you think that means and for the clubs in Europe.
Very damaging for football. The Super League is a wish of a couple of people.
Yeah.
But it's not the wish for everyone in football. is something similar when they wanted to start, or it's still in plan to start the semi-professional league in the Caribbean. And now they was talking about only countries that have X amount of population. And you would have to have this and all of these requirements that obviously we don't have.
Right.
So countries like us, like Bermuda, like Anguilla, and those small countries wouldn't have a say.
Right.
So I wouldn't support it. I'm not good. I don't think I don't think 90% of the football family or fraternity would support it.
Yeah.
So it's a lot of money. It become a money super league.
Yep.
And obviously not everyone would support it. So I'm against it. I'm not into it.
Perfect. Well, Mr. Whittaker, I always appreciate your presence here with me and joining me on the show as always, and I just want to wish you all the best with the association and building football in Cayman as a whole. Thank you for joining me.
Thank you. The national team start preparation.
Yep.
For the next round of games, I'm pretty sure and confident that this round would be different. Always good to be here. Appreciate your contribution towards the sports, and to always being there for when the big events happen and the big moments in football. We take the opportunity to congratulate Scholars Girls.
Yep.
That they win the league on Sunday. Very exciting league. We could have a winner in both venues, so it was good. Congratulations to them.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Whittaker. Cayman Compass, Seaford Russell Jr. reporting. Until next time, have a good one.